soul. This bag of bones. I tried with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. Just when I ran out of road, I met a man and I didn't know. He told me that I was not alone. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the master, I thank the savior. Ashes in the wind. So long to my old friend. Burden and bitterness, you just keep on moving. You're not welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. My wayward son is found his way back.
I know everybody should be standing up. We're going to do birthdays and anniversaries. Hallelujah. It's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. Amen. So if anybody's had a birthday or an anniversary, come on up. We want to sing to you. That's the least we can do. Come on. Now I think Elena's just going to come up here and sing with me. I think Gail's coming up just to sing with me. So it looks like nobody's getting older. Hallelujah. Wow. It just feels like me getting older, apparently. All right. If everybody's hearts are good, we're going to start praise and worship. How about that? Amen. Go ahead, Sage. If it gets too loud, sorry. Let everything that has breath, praise the Lord! Praise the Lord! Come on! Let everything that has breath,
that has breath,
praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord! I'll praise you in the valley.
Praise you on the mountain.
Come on! I'll praise you when I'm sure. And I'll praise you when I'm doubting.
the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'll praise you when I feel it. I'll praise you when I don't. I'll praise you because I know you're still in control.
Hallelujah.
Because my praise is a weapon. It's more than a sound. Oh, my praise is the shout that brings Jericho down.
Hallelujah.
As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul.
Praise him, hallelujah. That's all we came in here to do is to praise him. He woke me up to praise him. That's my job is to praise him, hallelujah. Woo! Listen.
I'll praise because you're sovereign. Praise because you reign. Praise because you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise because you're faithful. Praise because you're true. Praise because there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise because you're sovereign. Praise God you reign. Praise God you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise God you're faithful. Praise God you're true. Praise God there's nobody greater than you.
Praise
the Lord, oh my soul.
They might be awake though. What do you think? You guys can't hear you? Okay, well we'll crank it up over here then. All right. Okay. All right.
Shakes that whole earth with holy thunder and leads us that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above.
About why you sing so much about grace. Man, without it, I'm lost. I'm done. If it wasn't for grace, I'm out of here. I ain't got no chance whatsoever to follow these laws. Whew. Listen. How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets. I look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him through all eternity. Amen. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord.
Amen. In every prayer we pray in desperation, the songs of faith we sing through doubt and fear. In the end, we'll see that it was worth it. When he returns, he's gonna wipe away all tears. And there
on that day, we're going to join the resurrection. Stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations, they'll sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we'll join the rest and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations, we'll sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever he shall reign.
Let it be today, we shout the hymn of heaven.
Away, and I want to see him again. But I want to see that guy that gave his life for me. I want to kneel at the feet of Jesus. That's what I want to do. Hallelujah. You know, many times I fail you, Lord, and I don't mean to.
If I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will sing. Thank you for the life. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for the way. And listen to our hearts, hear our spirit sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you of our love. Just listen to our hearts.
Sometimes I sit and I pray and I don't even know what to pray sometimes, Lord. But you know what's in my heart. You know what's in there. Sometimes the words don't even come out right.
Listen to my heart, every beat will sing. Thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart.
Amen. Let's remain standing, will you? If you're glad to be here this morning, say amen. Let's give the Lord a good hand clap of praise, will you? We want to thank the Lord today for a wonderful Thanksgiving. We are blessed tremendously to have freedom, that we could come together with our families. Now let's take a moment of honesty. If you ate too much, will you raise your hand? Amen. It was good. Amen. You eat that kind of food every day to kill you. But it was good and wonderful. When our family meets together every year, you know, Judge Lockamy is a relative of mine, my mama's brother. He wants to share the history and how Thanksgiving was founded. And we appreciate that. But I want to appreciate the opportunity of having family together when you can have your parents with you. People were gathered there who were in their 90s, and God has blessed us. We thank God for the time we spend together with our family. Will you say amen? It's good to be here today with God's family, and I want to tell you something. The Lord is preparing a table for us that our enemies cannot come to, and we're going to have a feast in glory. Will you say amen? And that's why I'm encouraging you to bring a family member. Bring somebody with you when we come to the house of the Lord. That's what we want to do. We want to pray together this morning. We thank the Lord for this opportunity to be in the house of the Lord. If you have a special need today, will you raise your hand, please? Let's pray together. Father, we want to thank you. We praise you because you're God. And we thank you, dear Lord God, for meeting us here. You said we're two or three to gather together. Lord, in your name, there you would be among us. And we thank you, dear God. And we know, Lord, because you hear, anything, all things are possible. And we pray, Lord Jesus, for everyone here. God, before we leave this place today, your sanctuary, everyone would know you as Lord and Savior. We thank you, dear Lord God, for the gathering that we could come together. Praise your holy name, for you alone are holy, and you alone are God. You are the only true and living God. And we praise you for this time. We thank you, Lord God, for this season of Thanksgiving, and then Christmas, the birth of our Savior. God, we want to praise you, Lord God, that we have an opportunity to be in your house. And we pray, Lord God, that you would speak to our hearts. God, we pray, Lord, there are things in our life that, God, need to be removed, Lord, that we would leave them here in this altar today. There's things, Lord God, of you that we need, God, to add to our life that we need to do, obeying your word. God, help us, Lord God, to receive them. Lord Jesus, not just hear it, but be doers of the word. We pray for anyone here today who's not saved. We pray, Lord, you would save their soul, not just to know about you, but know you in a personal way. We praise you and give you glory. Thank you for this good day. And the church said amen and amen. You may be seated. All right. While the boss lady is coming, let me remind you, I hate to tell you this, but our baptistry, the heater is not working. Now, if you're going to go get in that cold water today, you have been called to be a missionary to the farthest part of the earth. That water is freezing cold. Amen. So we would not dare ask you to be baptized today because of that. I'm sorry. I apologize. But the baptistry did not heat up. And so we're going to fix that and postpone baptism to a later date. We'll give you a heads-up time so you can prepare at least a week or two ahead so we can make sure that you be prepared for baptism. So we apologize, but the heater is not working. That water is ice cold. And I would not want to put you in there during that time, okay? If you love the preacher, say amen. Sorry so much. Thank you.
The song about the resurrection and what Pastor just said reminds me of something that I heard on the way to church this morning. I wanted to share it with you. I shared it with the Sunday school class. There's so many scripture in the Old Testament about the resurrection from the dead. Job 19:25-26, Job said, I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. Psalm 49:15 says, but God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. Daniel 12:2, multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Heaven and hell are real. Isaiah 26:19, but your dead will live, Lord. Their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in the dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead. What a beautiful plan that he has for us, and that he already made it clear through the resurrection of Jesus. He, God, raised himself from the dead, and now that he's given us a portion of who he is, Holy Spirit, with Holy Spirit as our inheritance, believers will rise from the grave. I mean, what an exciting time that's going to be, because we're going to see that, whether we go now or he comes in the rapture. That's going to be an incredible moment, an incredible experience that is going to happen one time. It's a one-timer. That's it. Just like death, that's a one-time experience. Looking forward to it in a weird sort of way. I'm not telling you I don't have a little bit of like, oh, no, you know. But that's going to be incredible to experience that. And with all of our loved ones who've died in Christ. Talk about a Thanksgiving celebration. That's going to be awesome. That excites me. Amen.
Let's all stand together and give the Lord a good hand clap for his word. Amen. Let's give God a good hand clap for his word. Amen. You know, you can look from Genesis to Revelation in the Bible, and there's words all through the scripture that bear witness to other scriptures, whether it's new or old or new. You can find it in there. It's everywhere. And the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He's an unchanging God. We the ones who need to change. Amen. Thank you so much for being faithful. We look in wonderful time ahead for us for Christmas. We're looking for God to bless in a mighty way. Thank you for how you are and who you are. Let's remember now, is anyone here today that brought a family member or friend and you want to come up and sign our picture? Anybody? Bring somebody with you today. You want to come up and sign our picture. You want to bring family. And I said this before now, and don't want to be speaking about things that no one likes to take part in, but if someone loses a loved one, we fill the church up. When that person's gone and died, why don't we come to church while they're alive with them? Amen. And sit with them in the house of God that we can celebrate life. Say amen. Come on now. So we can all worship the Lord together. The Lord's coming back. Thank you so much about giving. You know, we are people of God and we systematically give. We don't just give once a time a year, all the time. We give to the Lord because God always gives to us. We thank God today. Listen, it's good to have friends that you can partner with, but the greatest partner you ever have is God. If you'll partner with God, bring your tithe into the storehouse. He said, I will open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing so great and so mighty, you don't even know what to do with it. Would you say amen? God don't send just a little drip. He pours it out on you. If God's poured out on you, say amen. So we want to bless the Lord today, worshiping the Lord in giving. When we bring our tithes and offerings to the house of God, it's an act of worship. We want to worship Him. So we're going to pray. And then we're going to ask you if you will to bring your tithes and offering to the Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. And don't ever think what you give does not make a difference. Because you do make a difference in your faithfulness. Let's pray and ask God to bless our time of giving. Let's pray together.
Father, we love you so much. And we thank you for all of who you are in our lives. We thank you for being such a giver to us. Thank you for being so faithful to us. Thank you for your tender hearted kindness and your mercies, oh God, that you extend to us. Thank you for reaching down and pulling us out of the miry clay and putting us on solid ground, Lord, through your Son Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for indwelling in us and being that inheritance, being that that seed that's going to resurrect us from the dead one day, oh God. We look forward to that. Thank you so much for your mighty plans in our lives. And we pray a blessing over each family that's here, Lord, their lives, their families, their homes. We pray for protection over their lives, Lord. We pray that you would continue to bless them, Lord, in a way that only you can, Father. And we praise you for that. In your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All the children and ladies and gentlemen, come quickly as we bring our tithes into the storehouse. Come quickly, if you will.
All right. Let me tell you that I got a good God. I'm normally here about 8 o'clock in the morning, and I go through all my songs I'm gonna do. And Lord, the works, and me and the Lord kind of work this stuff out what we're gonna do. And got into the office there, and I thought, we don't have a song to do for special. I never even got one. But on the way over there, a guy told me, he says, you know, I really need to hear this song. And I said, well, that's good, because I don't have one, so that'll work. So we'll do that one. I love it anyway. Go ahead, Sage.
suffer rejection and pay for the crimes he had not done. For what earthly reason would the Father let him hang on a tree? I wept with the answer, the one earthly reason was me.
Yeah.
Let's all stand together, will you? I don't know how you could be seated, stay seated. We were out here one day, and I said, Brother Billy, I remember a song a long time ago, and we found that song. I don't know why he does that to me, but he did. To really appreciate that song, you've got to find yourself one day alone. Just you and the Lord. Just you and the Lord. It's the only way you're going to ever appreciate that song. When you're all by yourself, and nobody can help you, and it's just you. And when no one could come to you, the Lord did. Amen. Can I get a witness? Give God a great big hand clap, will you? Come on now. Come on, give God a good hand clap this morning. I tell you, God is so good. Again, I apologize for the baptism being out of order. Last week, as we looked together in our study in the book of Mark, the first message we looked at together was about the messenger. God gives us evidence here how he had called John the Baptist to prepare the way for the Lord. In the message, God promised to send a messenger, and we call him the forerunner. And the mission of the messenger was to prepare the way, and we need to prepare our way. Then the spirit of God's messenger was, I must decrease that he may increase. And then the message of God's messenger was about the preeminence or the power that Jesus Christ is God. That he is God. And after hearing the message of the messenger, there must be repentance. And if we repent, there will be a reflection of our repentance. A lot of people say they say, but what does their life reflect? What does it show? I first want to say, notice in verse 9, the scripture says in Mark chapter 1, and it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in the Jordan. And straightway coming up of the water, out of the water, he saw the heavens open, and the Spirit like a dove descended upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You may be seated. May God bless his holy word. Father, we pray today in the name of Jesus. God, our desire above all things that you are glorified. And we thank you, Lord God, for your holy word. The Bible teaches us that the grass will wither, the flower will fade, but the word of God will stand forever. And we thank you, Lord God, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Only way that mankind can be saved and delivered from eternal damnation in hell forever is by the word of God. And we thank you for it, Lord Jesus. Today we pray, Lord God, you will speak to our hearts. And we thank you, dear God, that we can be here today. I ask, Lord Jesus, that no one would hear me, God, but God, we'd hear your voice. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for who you are. We ask, God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you would move, Lord God, in a mighty way. We thank you, we praise you, and we give you all the glory in the church. Say amen. We look together today, we're talking about the reflections of repentance. The reflection of repentance. Note that Jesus had gave us a perfect example of what we ought to do after we repent. If we think about salvation, and salvation, we see like Jesus here, he had left where he was born in Galilee, in Nazareth. And the Bible said he went down where John the Baptist was baptizing. Now this is a picture of the old man becoming the new man. You know, when you get saved and you begin to live for the Lord, you got to leave your old life. People today want to get saved and keep living like you did before you got saved. Well, salvation and true salvation is the old man dies and now you're a new man. You become a new person. For salvation is to be openly reflected. Then we are baptized like Jesus. Actually, Jesus' baptism is a picture of what's happened when a person makes a decision for God. You trust Christ as your Lord and Savior. You obey the Word of God. Baptism does not save you. But it's a picture that you obeyed the Word of God. You got saved and then you were baptized. But notice the reflection here of real repentance. There's a decision for God and a submission to God. The Bible said in verse 9, and it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized in the Jordan of John. Now, Jesus' baptism involved a decision, or actually a surrender, a total surrender. And Jesus, before his baptism, like us, had what most people dreamed about. You think about his life. He had a happy home. He had a close-knit family. He had a profitable job. He was a carpenter. He had many friends. But yet, he left it all. So you cannot continue in the things of the world. Even the Bible says, and when Jesus says this, it kind of takes your breath away. He says you got to hate your mom and your daddy and your family. Not mean that you hate them, but you got to depart from them. You can't stick to your family and follow God. In other words, you can't depend on, because mom and daddy got saved, that you're saved. You got to be saved yourself. You got to leave them and come to God. It's just like I talked about earlier. When you meet the Lord, it's just you and God. It's just you and God. You're by yourself, and then you have salvation. Jesus left all, a total surrender. Jesus left all behind to be baptized by John there in the Jordan. Why? Because, listen, within the heart and mind of Jesus was the call of the Father to do the Father's will. Jesus said in John 5:19, verily, verily, did I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he seeth the Father do, for what things soever he doeth, doth also doeth the Son likewise. He imitated, he did exactly what the Father told him. So we got to learn a great truth here. If you're with me, say amen. When we surrender or submit to Christ, like Jesus did to the Father, then we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Let me just tell you something. Obeying the Word of God opens up the windows of heaven that you can have the abundant life. Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto ye, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, he shall do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. We're talking about a divine channel. You have repentance. You get saved. If you really got saved, then you live a life of submission and you surrender to God. This is real salvation. We have a lot of people who say a prayer, but they never got saved. They have worldly sorrow, but they don't have godly sorrow. There's no conviction about surrendering to the Lord Jesus, the Lordship of Jesus Christ. They want to live their life, not God's life. For Christ the Son made a decisive decision to submit to the Father, and Jesus is the one who makes the way for us. Then we repent and submit to Christ, and our life becomes a reflection that we have repented. As people said, you know, I knew you before, but you seem to be different now because something's different about you. That's a reflection about your life. You can see people, know people. You live in the place where you live. You see people you knew a long time ago. But can they tell that in your life that you're not the same person that you used to be? There's a reflection of salvation and real repentance. The results of a surrendered life. Matthew 5:6, and Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Now your good works are not for your glory. Your good works are for the glory of God. Whatever you're able to do to give God all the glory, God should always be glorified. You always give him the glory. I couldn't help but go to this scripture when I was reading this morning. I was reminded about how Paul, he said in Philippians 3:7, but what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. See, some people in the lost life, they gain all this popularity. You have all these lost friends. You live in a lost world. Everything about you is worldly. It's of the devil. It's of darkness. You've got to get rid of it. You've got to count that as lost, that you can live for the glory of God. The Apostle Paul had a lot of things to boast about. I mean, he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. I mean, he knew all the law, but he said, you know what? I'm going to get rid of all that law so I can know the Lord. That's what he did. Our submission bears light. Jesus' submission gave us life. Jesus became our sin bearer. He's the one who paid the price for our sins. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21, the Bible says, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but he committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed." Let me tell you something. The greatest healing that you're ever going to get is salvation. That God will save you and wash away all of your sins. As Billy was singing that song and talking about how God has pardoned our sins. You know, when you get saved, it's like you have all these accounts the devil brings before you. How many know the devil is the accuser of the brethren? He always tells you what you used to be. Would you say amen? And he writes them all on the board. And there comes Jesus with his blood. And he wipes all of it off the board. Because there's power in the blood of Jesus. I'm going to tell you one thing. I've been twice pardoned. When God saved me, he forgave me of all of my sins. And he loved me so much that when I got out of prison, I got a pardon from the state of South Carolina. I don't even have a record. If you got a speeding record, you got more record against you than the preacher does against you. You may not have went to jail for it, but you still got a record for it. God has pardoned me. Everything I've ever done, he washed it away by his precious blood. There's also a beginning and identification with God and his people. This is very important. Look in verse 9. "Again, it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in the Jordan." Now, baptism, again, is an act of reflection of our new beginning, a new life. The Bible said, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, all things have died. All things become new. You are a new person in the Lord Jesus. So baptism is the act of demonstration that reveals our identification with Christ. We are identified, listen, in an act of obedience that reflects Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. When we go in the pool, we're saying, you know what? I'm going to follow the Lord. I'm not going that way any longer. The preacher puts you in the water, and you go back as a picture of the death. That Jesus died completely and was buried. You don't bury people who have a virus or people who have a coma. He was dead and they put him in a grave. Somebody ought to say amen. He died for our sins on the cross of Calvary. He died, he was buried, and he rose on the third day. We go back in the water, we bring you out. It's a picture of resurrection. We died in the Lord Jesus. If somebody tells you the preacher died, they're a liar. I've already died in the Lord Jesus. Will you say amen? If absent from this body, I'm going to be in the presence of the Lord. And that ain't all. One day I'm going to get a new body. I'm going to see Christ. And behold, I'm going to be just like him. Somebody ought to shout and say amen. Baptism reflects our new life. That's our walk. Baptism reveals our new direction. That's the way that we go. Baptism reveals our new mission. This is where it lacks, our work. We think our work is where we go tomorrow morning. As a believer, you should be working every day for the church. You should be working every day for the building up of the kingdom of God. I tell you one thing, if you're still here, God thinks you ought to be working. If God's through with you, he'll take you home. So we all ought to be walking in the right way, and we all ought to be working. Now, Jesus now was launching, at this time when he was baptized into Jordan, he was launching his mission, his purpose, and his mandate. Now, don't forget now, Jesus is the Lamb of God who was slain before the foundation of the universe. Some of these preachers think they have a new understanding, a new theology, a new way of figuring out the Word of God. Let me tell you one thing. Jesus Christ is God. He was God, and he always will be God. He did not become God just because he got baptized in the River Jordan and the Holy Ghost came down upon him. He was God before anything ever was. And all things were created by him, and all things were created for the Lord Jesus. We're talking about your Savior. We're bragging on the Lord Jesus. I heard a man saying one time, if you get to preaching and you preach yourself about half to death, you ain't got nothing to say. Just say Jesus. Just say Jesus. Just say Jesus. Will you say amen? When all hell comes against you and the world comes against you, your family comes against you, people comes against you, just back up and say Jesus. That's all you have to say. God's divine order, we surrender to the Lord. We submit and we're sent. That's exactly what Jesus teaches us in verse 9. The Bible said he left where he was in Nazareth of Galilee, and he went down where John the Baptist was baptizing Gentiles. Listen very carefully. There's a beginning and an identification with God. It must be Christ, in Christ, in his death, burial, and resurrection, and with the people of God. Now, people say, I'm saved. I don't need to go to church. Well, you a liar. That ain't what the Bible says. The Bible says we not forsake the assembly of ourselves together. How can you claim that you're a part of the family of God when you don't never go home with the people of God? And let me tell you something right now. God is God, and this is not heaven, but I'm going to tell you something. This is God's holy sanctuary. And when you come to the house of God, you with the family of God, you in the presence of God, and you with God's people, it's identification and a reflection that you belong to God. All these people running up and down the road claiming they're saved. Listen very carefully. It's not true. Jesus left his family and friends who were of the law, Jewish people, left all behind and went to John the Baptist and was baptized of John. Again, no Jews at this time were baptized, only Gentiles. All I got to say is hallelujah. All I got to say is hallelujah. This was Christ's identification with the entire world. We all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen very carefully. This is a picture of what I want to think when I read this of our church. You know, some folks in those days thought the only ones that had a relationship or a future or had anything to do with God were Jewish people. Let me tell you something. Jesus rent that veil from top to bottom. And now, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord Jesus shall and can be saved. It don't matter if you're black, white, brown, orange, green. It don't matter what you have and don't have. You can be saved and you can become a part of the family of God. And I'm going to tell you something. May God get all the glory. It ain't got nothing to do with me, my wife, or my children. But this church here is here because it don't matter who you are. It don't matter if you got out of jail this morning and going back to jail today. These doors are open for anybody to come into the house of God. If everybody's not welcome to where you go to church, it ain't a church. John was preparing the way for the one whom was greater. And who was greater and the one who was preparing the way. Until Jesus was baptized into Jordan, there was a great gulf fixed. The only people that could go into the Holy of Holies behind the veil was the Jewish people. That's the way God made it with Abraham. Let me tell you something. Abraham had faith. The Bible said you're saved by grace through faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Abraham heard the voice of God, and he moved out of Ur of the Chaldees not knowing where he was going. That's what faith is. It's a substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. Get something. Faith is something. So faith is real. You move because you have faith in God. Jesus, listen, was baptized into Jordan. There's a great gulf fixed. The preparation, listen now, for our redemption on that day began when Jesus was baptized. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 8:9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes, our soul, he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. I tell you, I tell my grandchildren, anybody asked, I'm the richest man in Dillon. I'm telling you right now, if I need something, God will provide. Can I get a witness today? God will provide. Before Jesus was baptized, he possessed all the world could offer, had a good family, good friends, and a good home. And after Jesus was baptized, he said in Luke 9:58, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Now listen, church, the world is not our home. Amen. And we must, like Jesus, put it all behind us and take up our cross daily and follow the Lord Jesus. This would be an identification of our life with God's people. If we repent, I'm talking about a true salvation. This is what I want to call a divine swap. Jesus went from having all to having nothing. He left glory. God, Jesus Christ. They said, what shall we name him? Just name him Emmanuel, God with us. He left all. He laid it all down. No man took it. He laid it all aside, took on the form of a servant, and became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross. I often so wonder, and I heard about a church one time, that they had a split in the church because they put a Christmas tree in the sanctuary. I was looking at the Christmas tree today and thinking, you know what? Why we have a tree in our sanctuary? Because our Savior died on a tree. Don't you forget that. He died on a tree. He died for your sins and my sins. Nobody took it. He gave it. He laid it down. Amen. He's got power to take it up. If, listen, Jesus went from having all to having nothing, and in salvation, we went from having nothing to having all. We got everything we need. We're saved and sealed. Amen. We got security because of the power of the Holy Ghost. There is a commissioning and empowerment as well. Look in verse 10. And straightway cometh up out of the water, he saw the heavens open, and the Spirit like a dove descended upon Jesus. Now Jesus' baptism involves a commissioning and an empowering. It reveals in the heavenly open, it says in the heavens opening, and the Spirit descended upon him. Now let's remember now very carefully about God's divine economy, how God works. At salvation, the Spirit, he enters in our life. If you get saved, the Holy Ghost lives in you. I'm going to tell you something. The way you can find that out is you get busy and go out and tell people about Jesus. And when you meet somebody who's not saved and they say, pray for me, I want to get saved. And you take them down the Roman road and they ask Jesus to be their Lord and Savior. And that moment when they say yes to Jesus, the Holy Ghost comes inside of them. Your body becomes the temple of Almighty God. He lives inside of you. And then I'll say, are you saved? And you say, yes, I am. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. It's the evidence of your salvation. But also now, listen very carefully, church. Since you've been saved, not only do you need the Holy Spirit in you, you need the Holy Ghost on you. Would you say amen? You know why you come to church? I hope you come to church because you know we need a good bathing. We need a good washing of the Word of God. Will you say amen? Now, you're responsible to keep your own body clean, but you're also responsible to keep the spirit man clean. And the Word of God will wash you and keep you clean. You get out of church, you get away from the Word of God, the teaching and the preaching and the spitting of the Word of God, you're going to get filthy. You're going to look just like the world. You're going to smell like the world. You're going to desire the wants and the woos of the world. You'll be chasing the things of the world. Somebody help me preach today. We got to have a good washing of the Word of God. He rests upon us. Verse 10 says, and the Spirit like a dove descended upon him. Let me tell you something. It wasn't a dove that landed on him. The Bible said the Holy Ghost came like a dove sets down. He came upon Jesus. Jesus' commissioning was a dramatic moment. The word open there, when the heavens open, it really means it was rent or torn asunder apart. And in spite, listen now, the second, listen now, in a split second, in a moment, God the Father will tear back the clouds and the heavens and the barriers between heaven and earth, allows Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son, to see and to hear the approval and the presence of God the Father. This is my beloved Son, and who I'm well pleased. And let me tell you something, it's going to happen again. The Bible said in the same like manner, the Bible says, listen, it won't be long as it has been. In 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, a voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with them. We're going to be with God. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. Those who have already died in Christ, they come in with the Lord. We're going to meet them. So, church, after salvation, after we surrender, there will be a commissioning, a sending forth, a going out. Nobody wants to hear the Great Commission. I tell you, it's not just a commission. It's still great. Jesus said, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. Then he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now Jesus says we to go, and you will never have to go by yourself. You say, well, preacher, I can't get my husband to go with me. I can't get my wife to go with me. I can't get my children to go with me. I can't get my church to go with me. That's no excuse. God said no matter who does go or don't go, God said you ought to be going. Telling people about the grace of God Almighty. One glad morning we going up. That's the power of God. Somebody say amen. A very important fact and truth of this event is that Jesus' baptism, verse 10 reveals that Jesus of Nazareth is the Messiah, the anointed one, the Holy Spirit, gave the witness. It's the power of God, the Holy Spirit. This was unquestionably to Jesus unforgettable. The gift of the Holy Spirit is the power we receive from heaven as our earnest evidence and empowerment to go and do the work of evangelism, to tell everybody that we come in contact with that Jesus saves. The Bible said in John 1 and verse 32, John bare record, testified saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not. But he sent me to baptize with water. The same said unto me, upon whom thou seest the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptized with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. I like what John said there. John said, I saw it. Ain't nobody told me to say it. You hear what he said? I saw it when it happened. Nobody had to tell me what happened because I saw it. John was an eyewitness of the Holy Spirit to identify to a lost and dying world that Jesus is the Messiah, that Jesus Christ is the witness. Let me tell you something. Can you say that? Do you have to wonder and figure and try to work it out to figure out if he's the Savior? Let me tell you something. He is the one and only begotten Son of God. He is the Messiah. He is the Savior of the world. I'm the way, the truth, and the life, he said, and no man can get to the Father except by me. And Jesus is not a suggestion, and Jesus is not a good way. He's the only way. He's the only way that you can ever be saved. Another important fact of this event, of John's baptism, the dove that symbolizes peace and purity that Jesus alone can give and bring and offer to an unrested people, a sick traveling world, a sinful polluted world. Our world is getting worse, and as long as Jesus tarries, it's going to get worse. Don't think, well, oh my God, what's going on? You ain't seen nothing yet. It's going to get worse and worse and worse. It's going to wax worse. People today, they don't care what God sees. They don't care what they do. They do what they do. They don't even blush about it. It's an ongoing system of sin, and it's completely against God Almighty. We all agree, in spite of our lack of doing, when we've been commissioned by God and give God's Holy Spirit to empower us, the problem is the awareness and conviction of the commission and empowerment of God to do the work. He said, go ye therefore. All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. What are we afraid of? We got to be filled with the Spirit of God, not worrying what people think. So what makes the difference? Y'all still with me? Say amen. What makes the difference? We have, listen, too much of the world in us, and too much of the world a part of us. Listen, we allow the world's business to outrule God's given called business. We'll do anything people call us to do. Even people go and join organization and civic groups and all this, that, and the other in the name of God, in the name of love, and won't do nothing. Don't do nothing for the church. And to think what they do is going to get them to heaven. Ain't but one way you're going to get to heaven. It's by the word of God. The Bible says in John 4:34, Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. And our first, listen, 2 points make the difference. Our decision and our submission. Our beginning and our identification. And too many of us lack a consistent commitment to do both steps. The results, we wander through life unaware of God's commission and the presence of God the Holy Spirit, willing to empower us and to see God do what some people think is impossible. Let me tell you something. You know your own self. And you say, well, I just don't think that God could save me. God can save anybody. It don't matter who you are. I'll never forget it long as I live. I don't know if the man is still alive today, but you know this man I'm fixing to mention. Bill Pate was a coach at Lakeview for years. Wonderful success. Called me one day, said, I'm down here next to Sumter. I'm working here in a private school, and I want you to come down here and share your testimony. I wasn't even pastoring then. I wasn't long out of the penitentiary. I went down there and shared my testimony to those people in that school. 30 kids got saved. 30 people. I said, listen, just to make sure. I said, if you got saved, you didn't do what you did because the person beside you did it. You come over here and meet me in the corner. 30 people came over and met me in the corner. Bill Pate got in the car with me after that. Took me out to dinner on the way to eat dinner. He said, Ricky, I don't know that God can save me. He said, you don't know all the things I used to do. I was such an evil man. I said, brother, God will save anybody. God will save you. It don't matter what you did this morning. God's grace is greater than your sin. There's power in the blood of Jesus. God will save you. I tell you, he'll change you. You'll never be the same again. God will make you a new person in the Lord Jesus Christ. Say amen. There's a decision for God and a submission to God. There's a beginning and of identification with God and His people. If you're saved, let me tell you something. I love you. I hope you stay here. We all stay here till the Lord comes back. But let me tell you something. If you don't like it here, go to church somewhere else. Make sure you're in church. Make sure you identify with the body of Christ somewhere if you're saved. Say amen. Come on now. Now, I'm going to lock the door. I ain't going to let none of you get away. But you need to be in the house of God. You need to be in God's house. There's a commissioning, the empowerment. But lastly, there's an approval and an encouragement of God. God approves us. Listen very carefully here in the Scripture. Jesus' baptism involved God's approval and encouragement. What God the Father did for Jesus, His Son, was very profound. God said not only to His Son, but to all of us here today, "There are my beloved children, my Son, in whom I am well pleased." We ought to please the Father. Now, if Mark and Matthew and others there, including the religious Jews, heard the Father's voice of approval, why didn't they believe that Jesus was the Messiah? Because they were looking wrongly. They were looking for a ruler. They were looking for a great commander. They were looking for a king, a great conqueror. They missed the message of the messenger. Isn't it something that people can come to church all their life and die and go to hell? Because they may listen to the word and get it in their head, but they never get it in the heart. The Bible says, you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you will be saved. Behold, the Bible tells us, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John said in verse 8, "I indeed baptize you with water, but He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost." Baptism is a covering completely. Would you say amen? God needs to fill us. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We must be like Jesus taught us to be. Come out of the old life. Jesus left Nazareth. He could not stay there. He had to leave. He had to leave and follow the Lord. You got to make a decision. Submit to God. Call upon Jesus and be saved today. If you're not saved, if you're not really been saved, you need to call upon the Lord today and identify with God in Christ Jesus and God's people. We are God's family. Prove your redemption in our service and our commission. Be a living epistle, a rock of the power of God, the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you something. Everything that looks like a rock does not mean that it is a rock. You can look at a distance and see a big old dirt pile, dirt clog, what we used to call it, over there somewhere. And you say, "I got to go move that thing. I might stumble over it when I run by it and hit it with my foot." Well, unbeknown, if you just hit it with your foot, it ain't nothing but a little bit of smoke and powder. That's what some people's lives are. They may look like they're saved on the outside, but on the inside, they're empty. They're empty of God. I like what I heard Jack Graham say this morning on the television, that when he was a young boy, he asked his granddaddy to buy him some little bitties when he went around Easter and Christmas. And his granddaddy bought him some. They took him home. They didn't live on a farm. There was chickens all over the yard. Well, the chickens grew, and all of a sudden, Grandma said, "We're going to have chicken and dumpling for dinner." Y'all with me? Say amen. So before you know it, they snatched them chickens up fawns, cut the heads off, and them chickens were running around. They were dead and did not know it. Did you hear me now? They were dead and they did not even know they were dead. You will not know that you're dead except the Holy Ghost convicts you and calls you. You may look good, you may sing good, preach good, shout good, dress good, never miss a day of church and die and not know that you're dead and go to hell. Help me preach now. I'm telling you the truth. When you're saved, you're not your own. God has bought you with a price. We like Jesus will hear from heaven. You know, people say, "Well, God ain't spoke to me." Well, you need to get saved. You ought to get saved then. God didn't save you just to set you somewhere way over yonder. God saved you to speak to you. Would you say amen? The Bible says that God says, "They are my beloved son." Like he would say to you if you're saved, "You're my beloved children whom I'm well pleased." And then that day, the day of reckoning, because you've been saved, and not because of you, but because of the work of God, the Holy Spirit that called you out of darkness into his marvelous, majestic light and saved you and covered you with the blood of Jesus. He says, "Enter in, thy good and faithful servant." Christians serve God. We want to think this day and time, Christians come to church. I think they do, and I think they need to be serving God. You need to serve him. Listen very carefully. God always meets the need of his servants. You serve the Lord, he'll bankrupt heaven to take care of you. Come on now. God always reveals his will and gives us power to do his service. You know, as I was looking into scripture, you know, I'm going to tell you something. I don't just open the Bible and pick out something to preach. And you know, today we were planning for baptism. 3 weeks ago I said, "Lord, we've been preaching on the Holy Spirit. Now, God, direct me. Where do we need to be in the Word of God?" Now, you know, last week we began in the book of Mark. We did the first 8 verses. And who, unbeknown that the baptistry heater is not working, what are we preaching about today? Baptism. Baptism. God will direct your life. It don't, listen, I'm not surprised, not one bit, when God directs us in the direction that we need to go. God ain't going to lead you down a dead end and leave you all by yourself. That's what the devil did to me. He led me down a path that looked good and prosperous, felt good, looked good, smelled good. I thought I fit right in. I thought I was good. The devil will lead you down there and listen, and snatch your feet out from under you and leave you all by yourself down there desolate. Would you say amen? But God will provide for his people. God always, by the Holy Spirit, grants us assurance. We know that we're saved. We know we're going to be with heaven. I like what Paul said. I'm persuaded that he is able. Whatever you have need of, God's able. There's nothing that's too great for God. God can do anything. Would you say amen? Does your life reflect the redeeming power of God? Have you been to Jesus for his cleansing power? I'm not asking you now, do you know about Jesus? I'm asking you, do you know Jesus? Do you know him? Do you have conversation with him? Do you have fellowship with him? Do you know him? Do you know him in such a way, no matter what everybody else does, you know that Jesus is always with you and Jesus is always for you? Would you say amen? Come on now. Let me tell you something. There's power, wonder-working power in the blood of Jesus. I want you to stay on your feet, please, will you? Some preachers say, well, Jesus, you know, he didn't have power until that day when the Holy Spirit came down upon him in the Jordan River. Well, if that's so, well, then he's not God. Then he's not God. He has all power. Jesus is God. Jesus is available today to save you. If you're not saved today, I beseech you, I please, if you don't have peace in your life, as Jesus is your Lord and Savior, I'm going to step right down here. You can come and meet me today, and you can give your life to Jesus. You can be saved. You can leave here saved, secure, satisfied that God has saved you. And no matter what happens in our nation, no matter what happens in Israel, no matter what happens all over the world, it don't matter, because God has already prepared a place for us, and he's coming back for us again. Can you imagine if the Lord Jesus comes tomorrow, what this world is going to look like? We have not seen anything yet. It's amazing now. And so many people say no to Jesus. You've been in church. You've heard the word. You've been around Christian people. Are you saved? Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray if there's one more or many here today who has not been saved, born again by the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, I pray they would come today and give their life to you, Lord. And I thank you, dear Lord God, that you have a divine, eternal will that none should perish. That none should perish, but all should come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Will you come today? The Word of God is the power of God unto salvation. You've heard the Word today. Would you heed the Word? Would you receive it as your own? During this invitation, come quickly. Maybe you know somebody, as we have this song. Maybe you know somebody. Maybe you have a loved one or child, family member, friend, that's not saved. What are we going to do? Let them die? Let's get them to the house of God. For God is able. Come today, if you will. Give your life to Jesus. This is God's invitation. Come quickly.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. Perfect submission, and all is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps.
God loves you today.
So this is my story.
Nobody loves you like the Lord loves you.
This is my song.
He's waited on you. He's waiting.
Praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail.
God can turn it around for you. God can put it in the right direction for you. God loves you today. He loves you.
And he heard and he answered. I saw about the Lord, and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him, God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
I'm waiting on you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never.
The Lord a good hand clap, will you? Amen. I want to ask you to do something, not for me, but with me. We got December, then January and February, and then March. The first of every March here at Open Door, we have Family Day. So I want you to pray about this, that the first of March. Now, I'm not a prophet, okay? I knew the one. But by the 1st of March, this church would be full. It can happen if everybody would bring one person. Your family. Your family. How about your family? 3 months. One for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Ghost. Amen. That when we get here in March, you had to get here early to get a seat. So you got time. If that's okay, say amen. Praise the Lord. God is so good. Daddy, come and close us in prayer, will you? Amen. Let's give God a great big hand clap of praise, will you? Amen. 3 months now. 3 months. 3 months.
Heavenly Father, just thank you for the privilege of being in your house today to hear your word proclaimed. Father, help us as we come before you to open our eyes and look around us and see what's going on. Father, help us to realize our families aren't even showing up at church. Oh, Father, we need you to fill this place. Father, you're the ones who have to fill this place. We just need to do what we're supposed to do. But, Father, you can fill it. Bless each one here, Father, that came this way. Help them to open their eyes and look at the world that we're living in today. Oh, Father, forgive us where we fall short. Forgive us, Father, where we aren't pleasing in your sight. You know all, we know what to do. We just aren't doing it. And, Father, we need strength that only comes from you. Bless us as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before you leave, look to the person beside you and say, you sure look a whole lot better than you did last Sunday. Amen. Hug somebody before you leave.